From rags to riches, if you would only say you care. And though my pocket may be empty, I'd be a millionaire. My clothes may still be torn and tattered, but in my heart I'd be a king. Your love is all that ever mattered. It's everything. So open your arms and you'll open the door to every treasure that I'm hoping for. Hold me and kiss me and tell me you're mine evermore. Must I forever be a beggar whose golden dreams will not come true? Or will I go from rags to riches? My fate is up to you. Must I forever be a beggar whose golden dreams will not come true? Or will I go from rags to riches? My fate is up.
Cause I'm trimming my sails.
Greetings. I'm Josh Rabinowitz, Senior Vice President and Director of Music for the Grey Group out of New York City, and a columnist for Billboard Magazine, where I author With the Brand, a biweekly piece on music and branding. Welcome to our second annual Grey Music Seminar. As you can imagine, we are incredibly excited about today's event. Speaking of Billboard, which is considered by many to be the music industry's leading periodical, I want to read you an excerpted piece from the mag dated February 14, 2007. Here it goes. While many are still pontificating on the winners and losers of the 49th annual Grammy Awards, Josh Rabinowitz, Senior, blah, 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 cannot stop obsessing over one of the evening's acceptance speeches. For Rabinowitz, a telling moment, which may not have been apparent on TV, happened when Tony Bennett, along with Stevie Wonder, picked up the trophy for the best pop collaboration with vocals for the classic Stevie tune, For Once in My Life. When Mr. Bennett thanked his, quote, wonderful, end quote, sponsor, Target, Rabinowitz couldn't help but notice the snickers from seated VIPs, a sound which collectively yet subtly felt like an apparent condemnation of the brand's association. Rabinowitz, that's me, says, hauntingly ironic, these 30, 40, and 50-year-old players don't even realize how ahead of the curve Mr. Bennett, at the mere age of 80, actually is. I found this to be quite peculiar, to say the least, and certainly very, very revealing. It was clear that in 2007, many of the powers that be in the music industry still hadn't fully embraced the thrust of what branding can do for an artist's career. Notwithstanding the huge successes Mr. Bennett was having through his alignment with the powerhouse brand that Target had become. A few days later, Mr. Danny Bennett, who I will soon introduce, reached out to thank me for the quote. We subsequently met, and from that meeting, this seminar was born. Flash forward to today, 2008. What a different perspective the music industry now has. Cannes 2008 is flooded with music industry folk, collectively thirsting for an alignment with brands. After the massive successes of artists like the Israeli-born Yael Naim, whose sweet tune of innocence, New Soul, became a global hit because of its use in an Apple ad, AirBook ad. Incidentally, it is rumored that Steve Jobs himself chose the song. Or the Canadian artist Feist being propelled to global recognition through the use of her addictive track, 1, 2, 3, 4, for the Apple iPod Nano, or even epic recording artist Sarah Bareilles, whose international pop hit Love Song broke in the US through a Rhapsody ad. Interestingly, the song is rumored to be born out of a frustration about her handlers telling her that she needed to write an actual love song to increase her potential. Check out the lyrics. I'm not gonna write you a love song because you asked for it, because you need one, you see. I'm not gonna write you a love song because you tell me it's make or break in this, or you're on your way. Two other noteworthy branded music bits of news in the last year have been Groove Armada signing a deal directly with the Bacardi brand outside the jurisdiction of the record labels, and the Columbia Records release of John Legend's Live from Philadelphia CD, which topped the US charts and was available exclusively at but one retailer only, Target. That Target, also known as Target deal, was put together by our first speaker. This man is not only the man behind the man who has expertly guided his father Tony Bennett's career for the last 29 years, and a truly musical man in the music business, a rarity that I find. But our speaker is an award-winning music producer and executive music producer, and an award-winning television producer and executive television producer. He is a forward-thinking conceptualist on where the music business is going and a master marketeer. And he's a wonderful guy to boot. Please welcome the president of RPM Productions, Mr. Danny Bennett.
<You're wonderful. laughs> I'm a wonderful guy.
Next, I'm very proud to introduce our moderator. He's a former president of the Cannes juries and a winner of several Cannes Lion Awards. He's been responsible for much of the great advertising coming out of the UK and the US and now the globe. He is the vice chairman and worldwide chief creative officer of the Grey Group, and a very musical man indeed. Please give a warm welcome to Mr. Tim Mellors. And now, I'm honored to present a classic individual, a true musical icon, a man whose music has moved people around the world for over 50 years. But wait, what better way to introduce the man than to show his work? Please lend your ears and eyes to this terrific sizzle film.
stepping out with my baby. Can't go wrong, cause I'm in right. Ask me when will the day be? The big day may be tonight. What a night! I left my
with 105 albums selling more than 50 million copies, Tony Bennett has come to represent the essence of elegance, tradition, and artistic accomplishment.
And the album of the year goes to Tony Bennett.
Golden Sun.
With a cutting-edge credibility, Tony Bennett redefined style and sophistication for a whole new generation.
I want my MTV. I left my heart.
Give it away, give it away, give it away now.
I know I'd go from rags to riches.
As an American institution, Tony Bennett is regularly featured on television. In movies.
Tony? Can you do one more song?
Oh, anything you want.
And worldwide career highlights.
That's really beautiful, Mr. Bennett. But if you're gonna write a check for these CDs, I still need to see some ID.
Tony Bennett has been associated with a select number of established brands which reflect his taste and sensibility.
I left my ID in
San Francisco.
Very funny.
The best is yet to come, and babe, won't it?
Happy birthday, Tony.
In 2006, Tony Bennett celebrated his 80th birthday with a series of groundbreaking events, including the Duet CD, which featured Tony's greatest hits with some of today's biggest stars. In a career spanning over 55 years, Duets has become his biggest selling album, with over 3 million records sold worldwide, 2 Grammy Awards, and unanimous critical acclaim.
When I come home to you, San Francisco, your golden sun will shine for me.
Ladies and gentlemen, the institution, please welcome Columbia recording artist and a living legend from Astoria, Queens. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Tony Bennett.
Thank you. Thank you.
He's milking him already.
He's pointing.
Oh, boy. Thank you.
Good morning, or afternoon as it now is. Thank you all for coming to this, our second seminar on music. And I'm delighted to invite, to acknowledge the presence of both Danny and Tony Bennett. What we're going to do is have a chat around the idea of music's importance and, of course, how it relates to marketing. But first, I want to start with a general question for both of you. It's been said that music, possibly more than anything, cuts across boundaries, cuts across creed, cuts across nations. It unites in a way that television or cinema, possibly the only other thing that would could have that claim is art. But what is the magic about music that brings people together?
Well, it's something that, if you're blessed like I am with the fact that I have to do it, it's not, I don't want to do it, I have to do it. You just, I was born with a passion to sing and paint. I love being an artist, and I love being called an artist. I love the whole idea of communicating, and music is unbelievable. I often think of, to answer your question correctly, I think of people, I sense that people on death row probably can't hear music. You know, the people with, it allows, the real music gives you soul. It makes you a human being when you feel or listen to something that's performed so beautifully in any so-called category, you know, if it's great music. You know, the late Duke Ellington used to quote Toscanini. He said, music is either good or it isn't. It's not someone's opinion.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's a very correct statement. The real music lasts forever and never becomes dated.
So you're saying, in a sense, well, you're saying very directly, it's a life force. It has this life force. And the interpretation of the singer or the musician mm-hmm. may vary, but it contacts in a particular way. I just noticed on that clip, you sang possibly your theme tune, San Francisco, but you sang it in two very different ways
right.
in the clip. And that's you addressing an audience in different ways, or how every you night. Feel that day?
I never sing the same way. I love the invention of jazz that came out of the United States and the improvisation, so that every night or every moment on the stage, I just wait for the right moment, and it changes. It's never the same show. A lot of people say to me, do you get tired of singing San Francisco night after night? And I say, do you get tired of making love? That song, that particular song, has made me an international artist. I've been commissioned to sing it in every country in the world, and I thank my blessing for that wonderful song that was given to me by my accompanist at the time, Ralph Sharon, who is a magnificent musician. And I'm surrounded by great musicians at all times. I must tell you that the premise that I have is a little different from what you would expect the music world is. I try to make music that will become catalog. I don't like obsolescent music. I don't like music that will last 13 weeks and be quickly forgotten.
Right.
I try to make something, when I make a recording, I don't release it unless I feel that 20 or 30 or 40 years from now, it will still sound, it won't sound dated. I've always had the best musicians, the best sound engineers, the best studios to record in. My other son, Degal, has a beautiful studio, the Bennett Studio in Englewood, New Jersey. And the studio is so comfortable to perform in. It's in a hall like this. It sounds so. You record in a live studio audience, but without the audience. But you have great acoustics. So the quality. I'm more interested in quality, because I want my music to last. Because I have a wonderful family, and after I'm gone, I want to make sure that they have a lot of royalties coming at them.
I think that takes me over to Danny. Now, Danny.
Wait, can I, about music different than all the other arts, I think that what's important is that, and we don't talk about this a lot, but music is accessible.
Yes.
So we can hear it any time. You have to go to a museum to see the painting.
You
have to go to the, you know, the ballet to see dance. But what that does is it makes music, it makes it the soundtrack of your life.
Yes.
The first
yes.
kiss, the first date, the first whatever, you know, and you're making those connections so that it's like home cooking. When
yes.
you hear a song, it takes you instantly right back to when you first heard that song. And I think that's completely different than any of the arts. And that's why I think it has become important in terms of we've seen with advertising, because it makes that connection. It immediately brings you back to whatever notion you're trying to get across to the consumer.
I think it's quite interesting there. You use the analogy of your first, the background to your life, your first date, love. Tony's saying that...
Well, adolescence.
Later, of course. I think one of the interesting things is many people, they really believe that a song is sung for them. And it is...
Yes.
It reminds them of a particular person and a particular moment in their life. Yeah. And that, I think, is music's great power, that is instantaneous. Mm-hmm. I think the iPod, for example, has made that even more... People, you just look at people on a bus and they've all got an iPod. And they're in their own world. So when you talk about looking for a catalogue or a standard, I've always wondered what makes a standard? What's the quality about it that brings it above and makes it last for 50, 60 years?
Mostly great composers. In the United States, like in France, at the turn of the century, you had a renaissance of Ravel, Debussy, Tchaikovsky, and then you had, in painting, you had Monet and Van Gogh and all the great painters of Impressionism. In the United States in the 20s and 30s and 40s, way before my time.
Of course. Pause to look out to the audience.
The record companies say, well, that's old music. I say, wait a minute. There's never been better popular music in the world written outside of maybe one song in Italy called O Sole Mio. But the rest of the songs, when you have Cole Porter, George Gershwin, Johnny Mercer, you know, the best composers was a renaissance that is hard to find today. There was a quality of their music that will never die. And you have the great singers like Sinatra and Nat King Cole, Ella Fitzgerald, and great musicians like Oscar Peterson and Fats Waller and Art Tatum, and the great jazz artists like Stan Getz and Miles Davis. That music will never die. In fact, I think Danny was telling me that the Sony Columbia that I belong to, that 90% of the sales is this catalog.
Yeah.
It's not the contemporary. I mean, I understand that the record company gets so big, they have many employees, and every week they have to pay the employees to keep going and all that. So they come out with something quick that will be quickly forgotten. But in the meantime, the fact that a company has 90% of their sales are these great performances, and that, to me, that's the premise that I work by. I try to include a recording into my catalog that will live on and keep the company going.
Mm. Yeah, and for me, it's the same thing, and I always say this, but people ask me about, you know, what it's like managing your father, and pretty good, thank you. But I always say, like, I'm not the difference. The different approach for me is I don't handle a career. I'm managing a legacy, and everything we do is about three steps ahead. So, you know, where is this going with regards to the legacy? And it's a completely different mindset than the record labels have at this point. As a result, and I get very discouraged hearing about our industry being in the toilet all the time. It's very negative. And you know, what's in the toilet right now is the music industry as we know it. Its CD sales are in the toilet, but the ability for us to be able to reach a massive amount of audience right now is, there's never been better opportunity for us. And they're just not seeing the forest through the trees. And I often say to them in meetings, you know, it's if you take the map of whatever country you're from and turn it upside down, you know all the places, but it looks really strange. And that's what they're doing. They're in the same environment, but the map's upside down, and they have this inability to have a point. Their point of reference is completely off. But, I mean, that's the most exciting thing. Tony's like, you know, again, you know, what was the quote that... The New York Times said that, you know, didn't bridge the generation gap, he demolished it. And the reason for that is because he doesn't think demographics. It's like saying to a 10-year-old, oh no, you can't go see a Van Gogh painting, you know, you'll never understand it. It's not about understanding, it's about feeling. It's that, that's where it comes from, and we lose sight of the fact that it's a product, but it's not toothpaste. It breathes, it feels. And it is the thing that connects. And that's why over the last, you know, we're going on 30 years actually, of working together, I caught the notion that it isn't about generation. It's about that universal, you're like, what makes a hit song? What makes something catalog? It's the universal themes. It connects viscerally. And there's two separate issues. One is, you know, yes, the Hannah Montanas of the world, but then there's great music that connects, and that's multi-generational, and, you know, I think that, you know, Tony has proven that. He's, 81 years old and reaching as many fans, and we walk down the street, and a school bus pulls by, and they're all waving, hey, Tony. I mean, that's, you know, that's very rewarding to see.
I think it's interesting. One of the reasons I wanted to do these seminars is because of the people out in this audience, the people in camp at the moment, have an enormous power that sometimes they don't think about. Music is in the hands, or its dissemination, of commercial gain, really, in a new sense. That, I should say now, nearly two-thirds of commercials worldwide will have a track on them. And new album tracks are now disseminated instead of being put onto a CD or even onto that. They will go out on a commercial. That puts enormous power on one level and responsibility in the hands of the people in the
Absolutely.
Communication businesses.
The integrity is really important, and you watch sometimes where, again, it's, I mean, look, we all experience follow the leader, but you get a movie like Brother, Where Art Thou that sells, you know, millions of records, wins the Grammy, and now everybody wants music in the soundtrack, and they go running and stick it on anywhere that they can. The reason for that success, I feel, is that it was integral to the film. So it's very, very important where the success of that was you could not separate it from the movie itself, so that you were making that connection and people wanted to go out and get that, and they were compelled to as a result because it touched them. So even from the commercial point of view, I think it's important. It matters little whether it's 30 seconds or if it's 2 hours. It must be integral, and I think that if you look at the ones that have been successful with regards to, you know, pushing the sales, like, you know, like Feist and Sarah Bareilles, there was an emotional connection. You couldn't separate the two things, and I think that's really important. And to speak to your point, it's a tremendous responsibility to propagate not only what we do, but, you know, marketing and commercialism, and I'm always saying it's the balance between art and commerce. So to maintain the integrity and the great commercials, you know, artistic commercials are the ones that last forever and set that bar for people to go to the next level. And that's something that Tony has always done in music. And what we've talked about with Tony, and again, we've turned it upside down a little bit because it's always the marketers coming in saying, you know, oh, okay, Tony, you got to get some leathers and some chains and really relate to the audience, you know. And that's a recipe for disaster.
You did do it once, though, at the MTV Awards.
Well,
you had
that,
the top hat.
That
was a one-off joke, wasn't it?
Well, it's to make impact. Obviously, that's you shake the bush, you drop a bomb. But, you know, and we did the thing with the Chili Peppers that you saw up here. We never did anything like that again. I mean, and that's keeping an eye on the integrity of it so that there's purpose to everything that one does. And it's not just, there's no easy way to do this.
Let me just come back to the singing. I read somewhere that you were trained in bel canto, which is obviously, what is it?
Yeah, I was in the Second World War, I was in France and Germany, and when I came back under the GI Bill of Rights, there was a lot of schooling that I missed being in the infantry in the war. And under the GI Bill of Rights, the American Theater Wing opened their heart and their arms to the soldiers that came back. It was, as they call, Studs Terkel calls it, the Good War. And as a result, they gave us the best teachers. And I had magnificent teachers in bel canto, so I could always control my voice throughout my life.
What does it actually mean? Beautiful.
It's based on the vowels of the A, E, I, O, U, and it's, you know, who am I? I mean, I have to. I do the same technique that Pavarotti, you know, who's the greatest singer that ever lived, as far as I'm concerned. And it keeps your voice very healthy. And it's not a matter of singing to, you know, volume. That's opera, and that's the real thing. That's the high level of classical music. But the art of intimate singing, which was invented by Bing Crosby and taught us all how to make a living as a popular singer, is very interesting, to sing intimately into the microphone. But your voice has to be in top shape. But then we also had a vocal coach, Mimi Spear, right on 52nd Street, the great jazz street. And she taught me to imitate musicians rather than to listen to another singer. One of the regrets I have about contemporary children that are just starting in show business is that they don't have the vaudeville training. Rosemary Clooney and I were the first American Idols years ago.
And, didn't you used to sing like Art Tatum and play the piano?
But just vaudeville training, you know, going from town to town. And I get a kick out of watching the politicians shaking hands and everything and going all over the country to hoping that they vote for you, you know. And here, I mean, Rosie Clooney and I, we did that for 7 years. We had million-selling records, but the masters like Jack Benny and George Burns and Bob Hope, they told us, well, you could start out, but it's going to take you 7 years to learn how to perform properly in front of an audience.
And Danny,
it takes 7 years, you know, so there's no... I'm interested in the new longevity of artists. There's too many that are shot up and made very famous, and then the second record doesn't work and they drop that artist and go with the next artist. It's a bit too cruel, instead of getting back to the star system where the public makes you an artist.
Yeah, because you do
teaching you from the audience. The audience is your teacher. They teach you how to perform properly, from going from night after night to one nice concert hall to another. And this would be a great hall to perform in.
It's the theory of American Idol, though, is that it does listen to the public in that way. Yeah. But my feeling is that it's a bit compressed. It's all too instant, as you say. They've not gone out on the boards and just done
their time.
It's
more commerce and less art.
Yeah. That's all. I mean, you were telling me that at one time, Tony used to do 10 shows a day.
Paramount Theatre. Yeah.
When was that?
Paramount Theatre. Yeah, you just, once you became successful, you'd start at 10 in the morning to 10 at night.
And that was being successful.
And that was the lines around the block, and you know, and but Dean Martin, Jerry Lewis, and of course Sinatra at the Paramount Theater, and Louis Prima and people like that. We ended up doing 7, 9 shows, sometimes 10 shows a day.
So in each of those little slots, a half an hour thing, would you change your performance?
Oh, all the time.
And what is it about? There's something about your connection. You did it as you came out here. You connect with an audience. There's an automatic.
Well,
it's like
I
invisible.
I love them. I mean, a lot of people, a lot of critics, you know, treat the public like they don't know, and you're above them, and you look down at the audience. That's so incorrect. It's unbelievable. To me, a mass audience has a touch of genius. They can sense right away just from the way someone walks out as to whether it's going to be a good performance or not. There's an intuitive feeling of a huge audience that senses when something is very good. It's like a good example is two jugglers will come out on stage in vaudeville, and they start with the pins, and no one knows. They're not celebrities, so no one knows who they are, but they go ticka 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 ticka. And as all of a sudden the public realizes, my God, they're not dropping those pins, they have perfect balance. And when they finally realize that, very quickly too, the audience will applaud them.
for doing it just right. Well, the audience is the great critic. They know right away if something is good. And also, there are many people that can't afford to come to a show, and they'll save up, if they like an artist, they'll save up for months to get enough money for a babysitter, for their children to stay home that night, and then go out to dinner, and then pay, you know, for the tickets for the theater. So, I mean, when you finally weigh the front of the audience, the ones that want to sit down front, they're your biggest fans.
But that's a revolution. That's a revolution that's happening now, though. That the industry, our industry, the music industry, they don't want to relinquish the control. And it's back to the public deciding, and that's what's great, because you know, they're calling them, you know, screenagers now, not teenagers, because that is how the distribution networks are different. They're sharing music all over the place. They're finding Ella Fitzgerald right along with you know, the Pixies. So
it's beautiful, and
they're finding equal value in both. And this is the first time that this is happening. There's this company called Threads. I don't know if you've seen this, a T-shirt company. And it just started out as web designers, 12 of them, passing around a design and seeing who could outdo each other across the web. And, you know, then they started a contest, who was going to do it better than the other person, and they all voted on it. Started with 12 people, and then they said, well, let's do a T-shirt design, and they did the same thing. And it just spread and spread, obviously, to MySpace and Facebook, et cetera. And now it's a $30 million business, where they're having people design T-shirts. All these, you know, millions of people are voting on what the best ones are, and then they put them up for sale. I mean, it sounds almost obvious, but it's giving the public what they want, and they're engaged. And performance and live performance is always an engagement, and I think that's why the difference between the studio or making movies, you know, you don't get the connection with the audience, and it really is a, I mean, as you always say, it takes two to tango. So, you know, the energy that a performer is getting from the audience is engagement, and that causes the level to go higher and higher. So you say, like, the jugglers, and they realize, oh, at that point, they're applauding, and then all of a sudden, they add a third one. You know, so they're listening, they're keying off of that. And I think our industry now, with, you know, the web being what it is and what it's become, more and more, our industry just can't handle that notion that we have to relinquish that control. And rather than listen to the public, they're trying to force the issue. You know, they're coming around to it now, but it's, I think, a little too late.
And with the jugglers, they're often used as an analogy, because what happens when they drop one is their whole performance collapses. And I think...
But the recovery is really...
Well, yeah. Thinking of... For me, the most... that moment for you in 1994, when you took the big risk. I mean, first of all, it's you and your father on one level, and you as an artist manager on another level, going out there with a whole new set of juggling things and saying, actually, I'm part of the MTV generation, you know. And in a way,
well, Tony always says to me, and very, I mean, I've been very inspired. This whole thing is about his philosophy. He says, Dan, when they zig, I want to zag. And it's really, I mean, it's a simple Zen notion, but it's really important in anything that we do, because resting on your laurels is the worst thing. You also call it moving the furniture around. It's always important. You know, there's an adage that Tony never sings the same thing once, and it's really true. It's always about reinvention. It's always about taking a chance, and that's what an audience really, you know, again, reacts to, because they're living vicariously through those performers. And it's extremely important. And we've lost that idea of spontaneity. We were talking about that with talk shows.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, when you used to do Carson, there was no rehearsal. I mean, the show taped at 5. We'd show up at 4:30. We didn't know what the questions were. And the band didn't even rehearse, right?
Right.
And now, we go to Leno's show or Letterman, they want us there at 11 o'clock in the morning for 6 o'clock taping. And then they want to rehearse it, they want to ask the questions, they want to see what works. But And Tony always insists, and it's a great thing because he's always, they come in and go, okay, so, you know, the PA comes in, here's the question, and he's like, no, I don't want any questions. And then, like, I got to go back to Letterman and tell them he won't answer the questions. And it's a constant struggle. But, of course, what you want is spontaneity. And that's really, you know, in fact, dropping the ball if you're juggling, the best thing is when they drop it, it bounces, and then they recover.
Yeah.
And again, it's the tightrope walk that I think keeps people engaged. And we've just lost sight of that. But I'm happy to say that I think that all is coming back again.
How did you feel when you went on to that MTV Unplugged? You got that tremendous reception, Artist and Song of the Year, platinum thing. Suddenly, a whole new thing opened up.
Yeah.
Because you juggled in an entirely... You took a big risk.
Well, we were on stage at one point. We were at RFK Stadium in Washington, D.C., 18,000 kids. Trent Reznor and Nine Inch Nails just went on. PJ Harvey's on after Tony, and we're about to go on stage, and Tony turns to me and says, would Frank do this? And I said, you know what? No, he wouldn't, and that's exactly why this is going to work. And it's about finding that niche. And it's not, we didn't want to, again, Sinatra's up here, and you don't want to compete with Sinatra, and we didn't want to do that. We wanted to create our own thing. And, you know, he went out, and it was tremendously sick. The crowd went crazy, and then we ended up doing a series of those across the U.S., and we did Glastonbury in the U.K., and doing things that you just wouldn't normally do, but there's a lot of thought behind it. It's not as if we're just doing everything, you know. So calculated chances, okay. No.
How did it feel
but
then?
But to answer your question, yeah. Really, What I like to say is that it taught me, when I heard the audience from an MTV crowd being more enthusiastic than their parents,
yeah.
I just said, from now on, I'm going to become anti-demographic. I'd rather...
Exactly.
I mean, you know...
Very good.
Because when you look back, you know, you learn from the past more than anything about the future. I mean, Picasso and Matisse went back to early Egypt, the beginning of civilization, and found out the colors that they were using. And then they just performed them. Well, all of a sudden I realized that Walt Disney, when he was alive and just searching about what to do, and Charlie Chaplin, the great masters of film, they played to the whole family. They didn't play to a demographic group. I mean, as great as the Beatles are and the Rolling Stones and Madonna and the contemporary artists, they're playing to a demographic group. But these great gentlemen were smart enough, and the corporations in those days, the MGMs and RKO, and they knew that they wanted to play to the whole family, because if something worked, just as a businessman, it's a bigger audience. It's not just a small group that everybody's playing to.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the whole world. You're playing to the whole world. The Chaplin film, the silent films were international. Everybody understood the comedy of pantomime. And Disney with his cartoons, Mickey Mouse and Minnie Mouse and Goofy and everyone else. And, you know, they played to the whole... made films like Fantasia. They made films that everybody understood, you know. And it's bigger business.
I think that's something that's changed in Cannes over the years. It used to be a very inward-looking. It was great. I mean, it was creative people. But what's happened is the big brands have come here. I mean, this year, for example, Procter & Gamble is going to be named as Advertiser of the Year. And I think they have that same... big view Disney and the one that you talk. That's, it's of necessity just in terms of reach that you have to do that now.
We just worked for a company 2 years ago now with Rob Marshall, a great director, and Target. They think that way. They think of the whole family.
Yes.
And they treat them with top class. The public, they want the public to be treated respectfully, and working with them was a revelation for me. I said, this is correct. This is not, They're not going for anything obsolescent. They want something that they want to serve the public with quality and where they can be trusted.
Once you get that, you're
home free.
They also do what I originally talked about. They don't have the product fit the marketing. They have the marketing fit the product.
Yes.
And it's a very important distinction that Target has done, so that, you know, products like Tide, you know, dishwashing detergent, is like, well, that's a challenge. Well, you know, they fit the marketing to the product in a very successful way. And it reminds me about the story that Tony always tells me about when Duke Ellington was dropped from his recording label, and I won't mention who dropped him from the label because he's pretty active. But this was back in the early 70s, and Duke went in, and the president of the company says, you know, I have some bad news for you. We're going to have to drop you from the label. And Duke was like, this is Duke Ellington, mind you, dropping him from the label. So anyway, Duke says, why? What's the problem? And he says, well, you know, you're not selling enough records. And Duke just like looked and said, I guess I had it backwards. I thought I was supposed to make the records and you were supposed to sell them.
Exactly.
That's good.
In this last couple of minutes, I wanted you to just take a look at what an amazingly good artist Tony is. These are some of his paintings. He doesn't know I was going to show this, but I
didn't either.
Well, no, that's good. Danny sent me a book, and I thought, he's very successful at it, which I'm sure he... but it's the same feeling. It's the same deep thing. Interestingly, this is a series I love here, from your apartment above Central Park. But it's very interesting that Target, one of the things that's noticeable about their work is they're artistically beautiful.
Amazing.
They're beautifully designed, and they use good music. So I think, you know, it's no surprise that someone with the vocal ability that you have should be as accomplished an artist, but I think it has that same depth about it.
I wish I could paint that big.
Yeah.
That'd be cool.
So it says on this clock, non, 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 so I'm afraid that's the end of our time.
Time's
this is
up.
Another great one.
Yeah.
I really would like to thank both of you for coming along today.
Oh, pleasure.
And as in these things normally, I learn so much, and I think it's so interesting to hear when anyone is an expert in anything. We were saying, we could get a plumber up here, it wouldn't be as big a turnout, and they could talk about
could
plumbing.
<be. laughs>
But in a way, it's talking about the artistry and what makes a great artist, and how that will go universally, and I think you've covered that brilliantly today. So thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
What'd you do?
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Very well done.
Thank you.
Well done. Good job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You can get Tony's sizzle reel actually on the way out if you'd like.
The loveliness of Paris seems somehow sadly gay. The glory that was Rome is of another day. I've been terribly alone and forgotten in